both of you. Thank you. I'm so excited to be here today, and I want to thank you for that really nice introduction. So how many of you have heard of The Real World on MTV? Some of you? It's like 25 years old now. So I was on the third season. My husband was on the fifth season. Our claim to fame, believe it or not, we are actually America's first ever reality TV couple. So the first couple to ever both come out of reality TV. My husband is the very first national politician to ever come out of, he's Congressman Sean Duffy from Wisconsin, to ever come out of national TV. So that makes Donald Trump is only the second national politician to come out of reality television. But even though a lot of people find it interesting that we got our start on reality TV and ended up in politics, what people are most curious about is how many kids we have, right? Eight, nine on, you know, another nine on the way here. I'm very pregnant right now. You can kind of see that. my 3-year-old asked me why I ate a baby. That's the only way you can explain what happened. But people really want to know what it's like to raise kids in this hyper-political family where dad's a congressman and mom is a Fox News contributor and pundit and conservative activist. And I always tell this true story about my son Jack, who's now 17, but when my husband first started in politics, he was maybe 12 or something, I think about 12. And no, he was 11, actually. And at the time, we had just moved into a rental house because of his job. And at the bottom of the rental house, there was a large basement that we called the toy room. And one day I went down to the toy room and it was an absolute disaster. And so I called all the kids down. I said, y'all have to pick up, you know, this mess. And I left and I came back about, you know, 15, 20 minutes later. And the room looked exactly the same. It was still an enormous mess, like a hurricane had come through it. And I said, what the heck happened here, guys? And Jack said, Mom, you know, Evita's my oldest, me and Evita, we picked up our mess. Everything you see here belongs to all the little kids. And I said what all of your moms would say. I said, I don't care who did it. No one's leaving this room until this is done, right? And so Jack got up and he walked across the room to pick up a toy. And I heard him mumble something. And I said, what did you say? And he said, nothing. And I said, no, I heard you mumble something. What did you say? And he said, nothing. And I looked at him and I said, Jack, what did you just say? And he said, fine, I called you a socialist. And that's what it's like, true story. So I wanted to start today by talking to you a little bit about the Covington High School scandal. How many of you heard of that? How many of you remember? So the last time I gave the speech, a lot of the kids didn't know much about it, so I kind of had a little bit of a background. So I'll just kind of refresh your memory for those of you who don't know about it or are having trouble recollecting. This whole incident, this scandal, started way back in January during the March for Life. I was there covering it for Fox News. But many high school kids, especially from Catholic and religious schools, end up going as a huge group to Washington, D.C. to March for Life. And so this group of Catholic high school boys were at the Lincoln Memorial after the march, waiting for their bus, their ride, to come and pick them up. And while they were there, there was this very strange group called the Black Israelites. I don't know who they are, you guys can look it up. And they began hurling insults at these kids, these mostly white Catholic schoolboys from Kentucky. And they said things like, you're incest babies. They called them future school shooters. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, this Native American man shows up. He claimed he was a Vietnam veteran. It turns out he wasn't, fake news. But he started approaching the boys and getting in their face, and he had a Native American drum, and he was drumming, and he was chanting, and he was in their face. And well, these teenage boys kind of unsurprisingly responded to all the, I mean, they found it amusing, right? All this chaos. I mean, they're you know, in Washington, D.C. And so their response was to sort of start to jump and dance along with the Native American guy who was drumming. But somebody caught part of this on camera and on video, on cell phone, and decided to post a clip of the Native American man in the face of one of these boys, a 15-year-old boy named Nicholas Sandman, and he kind of had a, you know, a little smirk on his face. And that clip went viral. I mean, positively viral. It was picked up by journalists, by pundits. There were even some conservative pundits, Greg Gutfeld, Meghan McCain, who weighed in and sort of registered their disgust with Sandman's smirk. But the liberal media ran endless, breathless stories using this clip as proof of white privilege, of arrogance. And this young 15-year-old boy became an instant symbol of everything that was wrong with white privilege, with conservatives, with Christians, especially Christian men in America. Now, I wanted to start to talk to you about this scandal because I think it's one of the best and most recent examples we have of what the left is trying to do to young activists like you, who they know are the future of this conservative movement. Now, from preschool through university, the liberals, the indoctrinators, have been working on you. They've been trying to indoctrinate you. They are angry that all of you somehow slipped through their little fingers. They're furious at you, that you have dared to defy them, that you have rejected the ideology that they have put in front of you day after day. How dare any of you be independent thinkers? How dare you register at YAF and attend a conservative conference or go to a Right to Life march? And they have tried to silence you into submission by threatening you with racism, sexism, homophobia, xenophobia, but you won't listen. That makes them really mad. Now, Nicholas Sandman and his school buddies did something else that you're not supposed to do. He wore a red Make America Great Again hat. And for wearing that hat, Nicholas Sandman was falsely accused of chanting Build That Wall in the face of the Black Israelites and the Native American man that was there. He was vilified on social media, I mean excoriated. He was branded a racist by America's political and media elites. Even the Catholic diocese that sponsored the boys to go out to the march piled on. Soon, though, more footage started to come out. And as this footage emerged, it began confirming the Catholic boys' version and their parents' version of what had happened. That it was the adults and not the boys who had hurled the insults, who had provoked and escalated this incident. Now, a week later, after all this indisputable video footage emerged, Nicholas Sandman appeared on the Today Show. I can tell you with my media experience, I probably would not have booked my son on the Today Show, but his PR team and his parents decided to do that. And when he got there, Savannah Guthrie, who's normally a you know, very maternal and good-natured person on the show, on the Today Show, she grilled and scolded this already, clearly, if you saw the interview, I don't know if any of you saw it, he was clearly still traumatized by what had gone on, what had happened to him. I thought it was one of the most shamefully insensitive and biased interviews I'd seen in a long time, especially considering the age of this kid and the trauma he had just been through. Now, I can tell you that if the group on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial had been a different group, let's say they were African-American or Latinos, and let's say they weren't at the Right to Life march, let's say they were at a more politically correct and liberally acceptable march in DC. And if those kids had been racially insulted and taunted by adults, had those kids responded by singing and chanting and doing their school fight song, those kids would have also ended up on the Today Show. Except they would have been celebrated for their restraint. And I assure you, they would have been proclaimed modern day civil rights heroes. Now, a month later, after that incident, there was another incident. Jesse Smollett, the Empire actor, perpetrated a hate crime hoax in Chicago. And he made sure to include the Red Hat in his story. He did that in order to create sympathy from the public and in order to extract more money from the executive producers of his hit show, with which he was in a contract negotiation. Actress Alyssa Milano, always quick to weigh in, declared on Twitter that the red MAGA hat was now the new white hood, that if you wear it, you must be the KKK. During Hat Day at a Florida school, a bus monitor was caught on a surveillance video pulling the hat off of a kid who on Hat Day decided to wear the red MAGA hat, and she berated him and called him a racist. My daughter attended Wisconsin Badger State Camp about a year ago, and a fellow camper there, also a girl, wore a red MAGA hat, and she was instructed to remove her hat because it was insensitive to the minority campers. In New Jersey, a 19-year-old progressive actually attacked an 81-year-old man for wearing a MAGA hat. You see, if you wear the MAGA hat, you're a racist. That's provocative of you to put that hat on, and that decision means you will deserve whatever abuse you get. So here's the number one lesson I got for conservative activists to take away from the Covington scandal. Cell phone video is your best friend. That's the number one thing. But there's another important lesson, because for once in this Covington case, and we also saw it in the Kavanaugh camp confirmation hearing, conservatives are beginning to do some of the right things when these incidents happen. When Covington happened, we pushed back hard as conservatives, as a movement. Once the extra video was recovered, proving the initial reports were 100% wrong, we used our social media platforms to spread the truth. We bypassed the fake mainstream media. We called out the liberal network journalists who gave fake stories and piled on. Conservative pundits like myself and others went on TV, and we took action, and we started to correct the record and defend these students. And I'm so heartened that we did, that we showed the liberal mob that we have power too. We refused as a movement to cower and leave these Covington High School pro-life marchers as collateral damage of the resistance and the identity politics war being waged by the left. You all sitting here are the future of our movement. Liberals know that you are the ones who will be America's defenders of liberty when we are gone. So make no mistake, the left's goal is to shame you into silence, to make you feel ashamed to be conservative or Republican. They want to smear you with charges of racism if you dare to speak up or speak your mind. And we cannot let them do that to you. You need to know that as a movement, we, the adults, a little older than you, that we will have your back, that we will defend your rights to be free and independent thinkers, to exercise your rights to free speech, to defend your right to even exist. And I am proud that as conservatives, we banded together and we had those kids back. But we had something else that day that we've never had before to bolster our efforts. We had a president who wasn't afraid to publicly lean into this injustice. Now, a different breed of Republicans, let's say a Mitt Romney, for example, he would have avoided this toxic story. You and I all know that. He would have issued some milquetoast, statement and about the need to withhold judgment until the facts come in, yada, yada, yada. In other words, until all of this dies down and the liberals get away with it. But not this president. He weighed in early with clarity. He even invited the boys to the White House. Take that, CNN. I have always predicted that for all his excesses, Donald Trump would teach Republicans and conservatives to fight like liberals, to be fearless, to knock these hypocrites down from their self-righteous pedestals. Our president did that again this week when he took on a person that everyone thought was untouchable, one of the most prominent and powerful black members of Congress, Congressman Elijah Cummings from Baltimore. Representative Cummings has been in Congress for almost 25 years. And during a recent congressional hearing, Chairman Cummings assailed the conditions of detention centers at our southern border. Detention centers, by the way, that his party doesn't want to fund. In response, Trump tweeted about the deplorable conditions for the black urban poor living in Cummings' Baltimore district, which, by the way, is one of the deadliest districts per capita, more murders than Chicago. Homicides are up 18% just this year. In the tweet, he told Cummings, but also Nancy Pelosi, who has her own district poverty problems, to spend more time caring about poor Americans who are living in their congressional districts. And for saying that, Donald Trump was roundly denounced as racist. Now, of course, Donald Trump heard that and he doubled down, right? He sent this tweet to Baltimore's black urban community activists, the people on the ground working with the poor. He said, quote, on Twitter, of course, right? Baltimore can be brought back, maybe even to new heights of success and glory, but not with King Elijah. When the leaders of Baltimore want to see the city rise again, I'm in a very beautiful oval-shaped office waiting for your call. That was awesome. And I'll tell you what, that strikes fear in the hearts of self-appointed minority leaders who think they own the black and minority voters, and they take them for granted because of that. Now, a week before that, Trump took on the anti-American rhetoric of the squad, again ignoring the predictable cries of racism. You are going to need that exact fearless spirit, that same political courage to be a conservative activist in the age of Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. As a conservative pundit who was the first Hispanic conservative on MTV's reality television show in the 1990s, The Real World, I learned the myth of liberal tolerance at a very, very young age. I was 22 when I did that show. As a Fox News contributor, as the spouse of a Republican member of Congress, I have been the target of vicious liberal online threats to my life and to my family's life. As the mother of a high school and college conservative activist, I've learned a few things about how to protect yourself from liberal indoctrination and outright smears. So I thought that I would take this time to share some of my insights with you. So number one, never man an information table by yourself. Why? You need at least one other person to videotape any harassment or violence. You all saw what happened to the Turning Point table in Berkeley. Did you guys see that one? The guy, the social justice warrior, just came up and just punched him right in the face and so hard. And just like with the Covington students, video was the only salvation. Without it, there would have been no justice for that activist. Number two, never lower yourself to the level of a liberal. No one in a pink pussy hat is worried about being punched or provoked or smeared with life-altering lies. Now, to you and me, the pink pussy hat represents abortion on demand through the ninth month and beyond. It represents murder. Yet we aren't going to demand that everyone remove the hat. And I'm glad about that. I'm actually really glad about that. I'm proud that liberal speakers on campus never have to feel like they are shut down or silenced. Their speeches are never canceled. It says a lot about who we are and how confident we are in our ideas and our political philosophy. Liberals live by Saul Alinsky's rules for radicals. Y'all know what rules for radicals are? If you don't know what the rules for radicals are, write that down and order the book. If you want to understand Donald Trump, you read The Art of the Deal. If you want to understand Barack Obama, AOC, Bernie, Elizabeth Warren, CNN, MSNBC, read Rules for Radicals. Believe it or not, Barack Obama actually taught a class on Rules for Radicals at University of Chicago. The rules basically say that the ends justify the means. Nothing, not even violence, is off the table when it comes to advancing the political and ideological objectives of the left. Conservative ideas, however, are winners. They're winners. Conservative ideas are winners. We are confident in our ideas because they actually work. Just think about Barack Obama. He had 8 years, 8 years to prove that his socialized, centralized, big government policies could work. But after 8 years, he proved they didn't. Millions fell into poverty, especially minorities and single women. Almost 3 million Hispanics fell into poverty during Obama's tenure. He tried to convince us that American manufacturing was dead. He said that the jobs were gone forever. You better get an environmental job. Manufacturing's gone. It's gone to China. It's gone to Mexico. It's gone to Vietnam. He said that 2% GDP was the new normal. He had the worst recovery since the Great Depression. And in just 2.5 years of Trump GOP policies, we are living in record-breaking economic times. This is, by the way, not just any recovery. This is a blue-collar recovery, the kind that Democrats always promised they would deliver and never did. Wages for workers are rising faster than for any other demographic. Manufacturing is back. In my hometown, manufacturing is putting people back to work. There aren't enough workers to fill the jobs that are needed. America just replaced Saudi Arabia as the number one energy producer in the world. Black and Hispanic unemployment numbers are at historic lows, and record numbers of people have replaced food stamps with work and financial independence, which is what they really want. We have so much to brag about. We don't need to browbeat or beat up anyone. Number three, know your stuff. Today, there is no excuse to not be at the top of your intellectual game as a conservative. Yes, you must watch and read the liberal stuff that's easy, it's disseminated everywhere. But get a steady diet of podcasts from Ben Shapiro, Michael Knowles, and others. Watch PragerU videos. Get the Fox News or Breitbart app. Download some of the great documentaries that we have on Fox Nation. I know it's a plug. But we do have great stuff. Your teacher's never going to tell you what really happened in the Clinton scandals. We have a documentary called The Clinton Scandals about Bill Clinton, Monica Lewinsky, Hillary. You watch that and you start to understand why Hillary Clinton actually thought and did get away with deleting FBI subpoenaed emails. You'll see why. Just watch it. This weekend, you're going to go home with an arm full of books that YAF is going to provide for you, books that you will never see in your curriculum at your university. Read the books. Put down the Snapchat and the Instagram. Do some reading. Do some deep thinking on these very important ideas and concepts. I highly recommend Dr. Bert Folsom's books. But there is a reason why Ben Shapiro, Michelle Malkin, Dana Loesch, Dinesh D'Souza, and others are so good at taking on the liberals. The reason is they are well-read and well-informed. Number four, don't trust your school administration. You must do your own homework. If your school or university administrator says you can't do or say something, check your school bylaws. My son tried to open a chapter at his Catholic high school, and the administration just ran him around. They tried to stop him at every single turn. They used every stall tactic. finally, they resorted to calling the group alt-right, including my Latino son. His crime? He wanted to commemorate 9/11 and denounce terrorism and radical Islamic terrorists with the 9/11 Project. Apparently, this was news to me as a parent, 9/11 is a PC minefield for university administrators who are so worried about offending somebody. I advise you to find a trusted faculty member who can help champion you as you have to navigate these things. And always, always call on the YAF staff, who are just amazing at helping you navigate the liberal tactics that are used to silence conservatives on campus. They've seen it all. They know all the tricks. They are very helpful. Number five, if you have a good case, I say sue them. Now, I'm not generally a litigious person. I know the president is. I'm not. I don't like to see people sue McDonald's because their coffee was too hot, or, you know, people watch their kids run across a public pool and they slip and then they sue the pool. I don't like that. But sometimes the only message people understand is money. No one likes to lose money, especially universities. So that's something that is always at your disposal to do if you reach the end of your game. I remember Donald Trump actually pulled the kid from Berkeley up on stage at one of his speeches, and he said, you know, this kid, he took a punch for all of us. And then he said, he's going to be a very rich man. I don't know if you're going to get rich off of it, but you might make a point. And I think YAF has done an excellent job of defending young people who've had their rights abused by campus bullies. You have to remember that your constitutional rights do not stop at the campus border. Your rights and your liberties are God-given, and American heroes shed blood for you to secure those rights. So stick up for yourself. Number six, play in the culture. If there's one thing I learned from getting my start on reality TV, it is that pop culture is powerful. Obama knows that, and he and Michelle used it quite effectively during their 8 years in office. Everyone thought that when Obama left office that Michelle Obama was going to run for politics, right? But you know what she said? She said, no, I can have more impact somewhere else. Where did she go? She joined the board of Netflix. So did Barack Obama. So did Susan Rice. AOC also understands the power of pop culture and social media. She is also effective and persuasive in that space. Donald Trump, he's a creature of pop culture. Now, I've studied this very closely. Those people who have been to YAF for many years know I do a whole thing on pop culture, and have been studying what Barack Obama has done, what the Republicans haven't done, what I've studied Donald Trump very closely, and I am absolutely convinced that the vitriol and the hate that you see directed towards Donald Trump is number one because the left hates him so much because he understands pop culture. They fear him because they fear the power that he wields in popular culture. This is a space that they thought they had cornered, that they jealously keep conservatives out of. The problem with Donald Trump for liberals is that Donald Trump was famous before politics. He was the star of The Apprentice. He was a funder of WWF, but not just a funder. He was actually a character in WWF, if you go back and look at the footage. He was a friend of Kanye and Pitbull before he was president, not after, like Barack Obama. It's why they attacked the hats. It's why they lost their minds when Kanye wore the hat and said that it made him feel like a superhero. You guys remember that? I love that. Donald Trump intuitively and instinctively plays in the culture. You could even go back to way before he was even a president. Believe it or not, do you guys remember Twilight? You guys remember Twilight? All you guys, little ladies read Twilight? Do you remember when Kirsten Stewart was dating the other actor in it, Robert Pattinson? Believe it or not, Donald Trump, before he was president, weighed in on the cheating scandal between those two. I'm going to read you the tweet because I love it. He said, you can go back and look it up. Robert Pattinson should not take Kirsten Stewart back. She cheated on, this is Donald Trump. She cheated on him like a dog, and she'll do it again. Just watch. Just watch. And then he added, he can do much better. He started his campaign by taking on Rosie O'Donnell. Remember when Megyn Kelly accused him of calling women dogs? And he said, no, only Rosie O'Donnell. That was his first line. Some people said he had me at Rosie O'Donnell. I said that. It's why he took on Meryl Streep, LeBron James, the NFL, Colin Kaepernick. A few weeks ago, he weighed in on Nike and the Betsy Ross sneakers. Don't ever think that pop culture is beneath you. Enjoy it, critique it, use it. The gatekeepers of pop culture are losing power every single day because of social media. And with social media, you have the power to be a culture maker. Support other conservatives on Twitter. R. Campo Steffi is my handle. And in comments, you know, sometimes we're out there and we're tweeting, we're getting a lot of abuse from liberals. It's kind of nice to hear something positive. If you have a knack for the arts, and there are people in this room who do, pursue it. We need more of you in the arts and entertainment. Our movement doesn't need another politician. We need filmmakers, we need writers, we need directors. Number 7, finally, is be a happy warrior. Our greatest example of this is President Reagan, of course. He was always cheerful. He disarmed his enemies with jokes and funny stories. He always made everyone around him feel good about themselves. Now, he's a very different man from Donald Trump, right? But who can deny that President Donald Trump looks like he's having a lot of fun out there? In fact, somebody called into Rush's show a few weeks ago and said, you know, I think he's the only president that looks like he's getting younger in office, which I actually thought was a good observation. You know, the left's favorite tactic with conservatives is to make us seem unrelatable or uncool. And when Donald Trump was elected to be president, they were so afraid of his pop culture influence that they actually started to say out loud in public, on shows, in magazines, things they used to say in private. Things like, don't normalize him. They used to say that, they used to do that to Republicans. Now they were actually saying it out loud. But that's what they're afraid of. They're afraid of normalizing conservatives. The more attractive we are, the more fun we have, the more engaged in culture and life we are, the angrier they get. So, have fun. Look good. Don't be ashamed to be a happy conservative warrior. Now, I want to switch gears just a little bit here to talk to you about what I think is the greatest challenge facing the conservative movement moving into 2020. And this challenge comes in the form of a very small Latina woman named Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. Now, I will tell you, I know a lot about feisty Latina women. I do. And I will tell you, we cannot, as a movement, underestimate her. She is powerful. She is courageous. She is economically illiterate. I will agree to that. But she is also incredibly savvy. Like Trump, she intuitively understands that politics is fought in the culture. Like Trump, she is authentic. Lover or not, she is authentic. She believes everything she says. She tells you exactly what she thinks. She is unfazed by her detractors. She takes on powerful people, and she knows how to win a Twitter war. But she has something very powerful that Donald Trump does not have, and has never had, and will never have. She has an adoring leftist media to help her cover up any of her gaffes and reframe everything to cast her in the best light. Now, the good news about AOC's takeover of the Democrat Party is that America is finally having an honest debate about socialism versus free market capitalism. And thanks to AOC, socialism is trendier than ever. Democrats, especially those who are running for president, the globalists out there, big tech, Hollywood, the media, our education monopoly, they are all promoting and celebrating socialism. And young conservatives like all of you here are the only thing that stands between their plan. Last year, paid membership dues to the Democrat Socialist Party was up 600%. In the recent midterm elections, 42 candidates for office ran with the official endorsement of the Democrat Socialist Party of America. In a recent poll, majority of millennials preferred to live in a socialist, communist, or fascist nation over a capitalist one. And that's true. This is a true poll. Students, unfortunately, are graduating from not just high school, but also college, historically and economically illiterate, just like AOC, because there are virtual textbook blackouts on the death and the destruction caused by communism and socialism. Now, it's ironic, of course, that AOC, a Latina, is the leader of the American Socialist Movement because no one knows better than Hispanics that these ideas don't work. I will tell you that the human heart desires freedom, and that includes economic freedom. Hispanics leave places like El Salvador and Mexico and other places where connections to government and power are rewarded instead of ingenuity and hard work. That's why they leave. Places where dictators promised utopia, but have turned their countries into living hell. There was recently some video footage unearthed of Bernie Sanders as a younger professor, but oddly, he looks about the same age, but it was from years and years ago. And he was talking about his excitement and all the thrill he felt at hearing about the unfolding of Fidel Castro's brutal revolution in Cuba. Shameful. Shameful. Now, I know that the Obamas, Beyonce, the Kardashians, they all think Cuba is this really hip new vacation spot. But I will tell you that for millions of Cubans, it is a place of unspeakable poverty and repression. I saw a Wall Street Journal insert magazine that was glamorizing retro Havana, and they had all these very emaciated, beautiful models leaning up against dilapidated buildings and cars from the 1950s that have been refurbished because they don't have nice modern cars there. It's Cuba. And it made me sick. And you'll see that, all you girls especially that are here, you'll see those retro Havana spreads and videos directed at us for us to look at. And I will tell you, the next time you see one of those magazines or one of those videos or one of those fashion shoots, I want you to think about the poverty and the repression that would drive a mother to put herself and her newborn baby infant into a rickety raft in shark-infested waters in the hopes of reaching our shores. I want you to think about Venezuela, because not long ago, Venezuela was the richest country in Latin America. If you ask any South American, Central American, they would say Venezuela is the jewel of Latin America, rich in resources, educated population. Socialism has now made it the poorest country in all of Latin America. And do not let your professors or Bernie Sanders or AOC or Michael Moore get away with saying, no, we didn't mean Venezuela. We meant Sweden. We meant Norway. That is a lie. Bernie Sanders is on record being a cheerleader for the revolution in Venezuela. So were Sean Penn, so was Danny Glover, so was Michael Moore, and other celebrities who gave aid and comfort to Hugo Chavez and now Nicolas Maduro. Bernie Sanders is actually on record in one of his websites. He said, "The American dream was more likely to be found in Venezuela than the United States of America." He wrote that. And then when the you-know-what hit the fan, he quietly took it off his website. And guess what? No one in the media has ever followed up on that. Chavez's fanboys in Hollywood, Sean Penn, Danny Glover, all those cool guys, nobody's ever asked them to apologize to the Venezuelan people. Today, once middle-class Venezuelans eat their pets, they dig through garbage to find food to feed their families. There was a story in the Washington Post or Examiner, I can't remember, one of them. Mothers cross the border from Venezuela over to Colombia to sell their bodies for groceries they can't find or even afford in Venezuela. And do you know what? There's such a demand. There's so many women wanting to do this because they just want to feed their kids, that women will bring their professional degrees with them, their degree from university or law school, their teaching certificate, to get a leg up in the prostitution business. Socialism always leads to desperation, to indignities, to hunger, and to death. I once went to a graduation ceremony for a bunch of Latin Americans who had been part of an English language course for the Libra Initiative, a group that I worked for. It was in a small little Guatemalan restaurant in, you know, Miami. It's like the size of the stage. And all the people got up and they were so grateful that I'm graduating from my English class. And they all had stories of how thankful they were for America and how thankful they were to the Libra Initiative for, you know, giving them this class so they could get ahead in America and achieve the American dream. But the best, the most emotional, the most poignant stories came from the Venezuelans because it's so recent for them. It's so real. It's so raw. One man stood up and he, even though it was an English language class, he said it in Spanish because he was just so overcome by emotion. And he said, "It's our job as parents to teach our kids that nothing is free." He said, "When the government comes to offer you something free, be wary." He said, "I don't care if it's a bag of rice or a washing machine. Nothing, nothing is worth your freedom." I'm here to tell you that you have a responsibility to be informed and to inform. I'm friends with Paul Ryan, but I'm here to tell you that we can't do this anymore with charts and graphs. We must speak with passion and heart about capitalism. It is not a bad word. It's not a bad word. It's a beautiful word. We need to own it. Capitalism, married with ethics and Christian morality, is very, very good for humankind. In all of human history, no other system of government has lifted more people out of poverty. And we also, as conservatives, as Republicans, need to brag about the amazing economic successes we've had in these 2.5 years. The media won't talk about it. The Democrats running for president are twisting the record, even though you can't, as we say in Spanish, tapar el sol con un dedo, you can't cover the sun with your thumb. We're all feeling it, right? Our movement's ideas lead to prosperity, to upward mobility, and the American dream. We are the movement of personal responsibility that rejects dependency and offers minorities and the poor what they really want. Financial independence, not scraps off the government table. Socialism is an evil ideology. No one wants to immigrate to socialist countries. There are no DACA kids lining up in Mexico City. No one's storming the borders into detention centers in Bolivia. AOC said that the world would end in 12 years because of climate change. You guys remember that? Well, guess what else she said? She said that the people of Central America are coming here because of climate change. Yes, she said that. I know, it's very stupid. They are not climate refugees. They are economic refugees. They're lining up to come here because of capitalism. and access to our free enterprise system. All of you here today have a patriotic responsibility to speak truth to power in the classroom, on social media. That's very important. And yes, during Thanksgiving dinner. If your parents are dyed-in-the-wool liberals and you can't change them, then you work on your siblings. You work on your nephews and your nieces. Because President Reagan was 100% right when he warned us that freedom is not passed along in the bloodstream. It must be taught and passed on to the next generation who will then fight for it themselves. This is like World War II or the Cold War during Reagan's time. This is a critical juncture in American history. This is a critical time. And the difference couldn't be more stark. Bernie Sanders cheers the Venezuelan revolution. We cheer the American revolution. They want to eliminate cows. We want to milk them and eat them. They told us the new normal is no economic recovery. Conservatives just delivered a blue-collar recovery. Liberal Democrats hamstrung our military. We're rebuilding our military. They ignored ISIS. We're destroying ISIS. They support open borders. We want secure borders. They believe in free college, free healthcare, free food, and free housing. And we believe in free speech, free enterprise, and freedom. This is the challenge of your generation, and we must engage in this battle for our country and make sure that we educate you and that you become the next generation of freedom-loving, happy warriors to take the place of aging Gen Xers like me and my husband when we are gone. I am here to tell you that nothing less than the future of this beautiful, blessed country is at stake, and our country depends on you. I want to thank you for having me here today. May God bless you and keep you, and I hope you have a great time for the rest of your conference. Thank you very much. I think I have time for maybe a couple questions, so we'll go ahead and do it.
My name is Jared Clyburn. I'm from Mississippi State University.
Great.
Do you believe that the leftist entertainment industry, specifically comedy, is endangering the ability of free thought and content subjectiveness in pop culture as a whole, not just politically?
Yeah, and I think they're just really unfunny. And I think you're starting to see a lot of comedians come out, whether it's Jerry Seinfeld, Bill Maher. There's a real concern even within the liberal bubble in Hollywood that comedy is dead. I mean, comedy relies on irreverence and the ability to cross lines and make people uncomfortable and think about things in different ways. And you even just saw this op-ed by Maureen Dowd. I mean, the quintessential New York Times liberal op-ed writer saying, you know, gosh, our party is now the party of Puritans. We don't like to have fun. And we're always sort of the scolds in the room. So I think that that's a great question. It's a problem for the left, and I think it's an opportunity for the right. Again, we have an opportunity to fill that space to be funny, but one of the things that we have to do if we want to do that is we will need to take on big tech. I think that is a much bigger influence right now in American culture than even the Hollywood was at one time. I think big tech is censoring. I think, I know they are. I know they've censored me and many others. And so I think that's probably one of the most important things that's happening One interesting thing is that on the left, there's Tulsi Gabbard, who's running for president, who's starting to champion that issue. So we might start to see some bipartisan support for that. There are whistleblowers, but I think that's a huge challenge for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi, my name's Karina, and I'm from Point Loma Nazarene University. And this question's for you because it's kind of about motherhood and parenting.
Sure.
And you have a lot of kids, so you're perfect to ask.
Yes.
But my family recently adopted a 13-year-old Latina, and she has been told her whole life, especially in California, that because she is Latina and she's adopted into a conservative family, we don't want her, and we don't want her there. And she's been told that basically because she doesn't know who her mother could have been illegal, and therefore we wouldn't even have her. And she's been told that we don't really want her.
Who's telling her that?
Everyone in her classes, everyone in her schools.
It's in California?
Mm-hmm. In San Diego, specifically. And I've heard from other like adopted kids, like, you don't want to go into a conservative family because they don't want you there in the first place. And I know the arguments to that concerning just like immigration and facts, but just from a, like a motherhood figure, like mother,
yeah.
Like one, we're gonna be parents like not that long, and I want to know like what's the best way to approach that, and from a loving stance and not just like telling them facts.
Right. Well, it's interesting because she's 13, right? So
yeah.
she's come with some formed ideas, and she's mm-hmm. obviously going to be susceptible to the influence of what she's hearing around her, unlike a toddler who, you know, wouldn't
yeah.
be influenced that way. So it's a very interesting situation. First of all, kudos to your family for adopting. That is one of the most beautiful pro-life decisions that anybody can make. So, Kira. I think that, you know, again, you know, I remember when I was talking to you guys, I said, you know, there's sort of the charts and graphs and facts kind of way, and then there's the heart.
Yeah.
And the heart always trumps the facts. I mean, you can go back, you have to have the facts behind you, supporting you, but the heart leads. And so you can tell her whatever you want about conservatives, but in the end, it's the example of your beautiful family that's going to change her mind. And so I would just say embrace her, love her. What's her name?
Allie.
Allie, embrace her, love her, show her that that these are myths. Again, we talk about the myth of liberal tolerance. The most intolerant people I know are liberals. And I have found, you know, that if you just love and show who you are as a family, I think that that's going to have more power over whatever anyone else is saying to her at recess or in some class. Or what she's hearing on the news, she's going to learn from you, and I think that's all you can do.
Okay.
I know
Thank
it'll
you.
Work out because it's clear that your family's heart is in the right place.
Thank you.
You got it. Thank you again. Enjoy your conference. Thank you.